أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم بس number 249 سورة المؤمن آية number 56-85 إن الذين يجادلون في آيات الله Indeed those people who dispute concerning the signs of Allah And how do they dispute concerning the signs of Allah? بغير سلطان أتاهم Without any sultan that has come to them. Atahum, it came to them, meaning any sultan that came to them, in other words, without any authority that they have. And what does it mean by doing jidal in the ayat of Allah? Trying to disprove them, arguing concerning them in order to refute them. So those people who try to do this with the ayat of Allah, whether kawni or shar'i, And how do they do it? بِغَيْرِ سُلْطَانٍ أَتَاهُمْ They have no authority, they have no right to do it. And when they do argue concerning the ayat of Allah, they have no evidence. So their argument is based on what? Falsehood. And the reason behind this jidal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, is that إِنْ فِي صُدُورِهِمْ إِلَّا كِبْرٌ There is not in their chests, in their hearts, except for pride. Meaning it's arrogance that leads them to dispute concerning the ayat of Allah. Because a person who is humble, when he hears that something is from Allah, then what would be his reaction? Of acceptance, of submission. And a person in whose heart is pride, in whose heart is arrogance, even if he hears the word of Allah, even if he hears the command of Allah, he will not accept it. Rather, he will argue concerning it. He will try to refute it. He will raise objections against it. So the reason behind this jidal is, إِن فِي صُدُورِهِمْ إِلَّا كِبْرٌ And this kibr, this pride, is against the truth. That they're too arrogant to accept it. They're too arrogant to submit to it. Because accepting the truth meant accepting the messenger. And accepting the messenger meant accepting his superiority above them. So, إِن فِي صُدُورِهِمْ إِلَّا كِبْرٌ And the reality of this kibr, Allah says, مَا هُمْ بِبَالِغِهِ They are not at all ones who will attain it. بَالِغِي is actually بَالِغِينَ plural of Baligh. And who is Baligh? One who attains, one who reaches. So they can never ever attain it. What does it refer to? It is understood as disproving the ayat, proving them as false, refuting them. So despite their many attempts to refute the ayat of Allah, argue concerning them, can they be successful in this effort? They cannot be. Because Allah will make the truth prevail. Secondly, بَالِغِيهِ It refers to their kibr, their pride. That the greatness they assume of themselves, they can never attain and satisfy that. And what is that greatness? Being superior to the messenger, being above the truth. Can they ever become superior to the messenger? No way. So, إِنْ فِي صُدُورِهِمْ إِلَّا كِبْرٌ And this kibr, this greatness that they assume of themselves, they can never attain it. فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ Therefore seek refuge with Allah. This command is for who? The Prophet ﷺ. إِنَّهُ هُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ Indeed he is the hearing, the one who is seeing. Meaning he hears their jidal and he sees the state that all of you are in. Now remember that Surah Ghafir is a Makki surah. And this verse is primarily referring to the people of Makkah. The people of Makkah, what was their attitude towards the ayat of Allah? The Qur'an, the miracles, the evidences of Tawheed that were presented to them. The Prophet ﷺ, what was their attitude? That despite the fact that the truth was manifest to them, the evidence of Tawheed was established, still they persisted on their false ways. And Tawheed was made very clear to them. If you think about it in the Qur'an, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has presented many, many examples, many proofs, which give us the evidence of Tawheed. But still we see that the mushrikeen of Makkah, they persisted on their false ways. And how did they defend themselves? By trying to refute the ayat of Allah. By trying to argue about them. Trying to raise objections against them. Trying to refute what the Prophet ﷺ said. And how would they do that? By using false evidences, by using mockery. And if you think about it, this is very similar to how Fir'aun opposed Musa ﷺ as well. Musa ﷺ presented the truth to him. that let the Bani Israel go, and we are the messengers of Rabbul Alameen. And Fir'aun, what was his way? Constantly raising objections, mockery. When the Rajulul Mu'min, he made his point very clear, what was the statement of Fir'aun? That, O Haman, build for me a tower, so that I can go up and see the Lord of Musa. And I think, in fact, that he's a liar. So, this is what? Jidal in the ayat of Allah. Instead of accepting the truth, using incorrect ways to, or false ways to, refute the ayat of Allah. Now, over here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us the reason. That why is it that a person does not accept the ayat of Allah, and instead he raises objections? Or instead he uses mockery. What is the reason behind that? In fi sudurihim illa kibarun. Because when the truth is so obvious, the evidence is established. Like in the story of Rajulul Mu'min we learn. Rajulul Mu'min, he warned them, he gave good news to them. He mentioned history, he mentioned facts. But still, it was as though Fir'aun was completely unaffected. What's the reason? Why? When the truth is crystal clear, why does a person persist on his false ways? It's arrogance, it's pride. Because accepting the messenger means accepting superiority of the messenger. And the one who is arrogant does not want that at all. Fir'aun, what was his problem? He declared to be God. If he believed in Musa alayhi salam, he would be accepting his superiority above him. So, the mushrikeen of Makkah, their attitude was also very similar to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. They did not want to accept his superiority. They did not want to admit that they were wrong. This is why one jidal after the other. In Surah Fussilat, ayah 26, we learn, وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَا تَسْمَعُوا لِهَذَا الْقُرْآنِ وَالْغَوْ فِيهِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَغْلِبُونَ. That those who disbelieve, they say, do not listen to this Qur'an and speak noisily during its recitation. That when the Prophet is reciting the Qur'an, start talking very noisily. Why? So that you are victorious. You prevail. The truth is not heard. People do not find out. And this is exactly what Fir'aun did as well. That Rajulul Mu'min is mentioning one thing after the other. And what does Fir'aun do? He disrupts his speech. And he says something that is completely nonsensical, distracting the people, so that the people don't get affected by the speech of the Rajul al-Mu'min. But what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say over here? That those who are arrogant in this way, they don't accept the truth, even though it is clear. مَا هُمْ بِبَالِغِهِ. This pride, they will never attain. This greatness, they will never attain. Because the one who refuses to accept the ayat of Allah, he's being arrogant. But can he really become great? The one who rejects the truth, can he become great? No. Because the one who becomes arrogant, Allah humiliates him. Fir'aun refused to accept. What happened to him? Allah caused him to drown. Him and all of his people. His entire civilization came to an end. His riches, his wealth did not avail him. His expertise did not avail him. Everything came to an end. So, مَا هُمْ بِبَالِغِهِ. This image of glory and greatness that they have of themselves, they can never attain it. And in this is a huge lesson for us. That if pride prevents a person from accepting the truth, no, I'm not going to accept this person's greatness. Why should I listen to them? Why should I listen to her? What's the reason behind that? I am better. I am better. But is a person really better? Can he really attain that glory, greatness above them? No. In fact, a person is only humiliating himself. Like for example, if a child behaves like this in front of his mother, that why should I listen to her? And he yells at her, who looks dumb? Who looks stupid? The child. He's only making a fool of himself. So مَا هُمْ بِبَالِغِهِ. When a person stands arrogantly against the ayat of Allah, he is only humiliating himself. He will never attain that glory. He will never attain that greatness. And also, مَا هُمْ بِبَالِغِهِ, the second meaning of he is to refute the ayat of Allah, to disprove them, to show them as lowly. Can they do that? They can never be successful. Because it is a promise of Allah, the truth will prevail. We learn in Surah At-Tawbah, ayah 32-33, that يُرِيدُونَ أَن يُطْفِئُوا نُورَ اللَّهِ بِأَفْوَاهِهِمْ وَيَأْبَى اللَّهُ إِلَّا أَن يُتِمَّ نُورَهُ وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْكَافِرُونَ. that the disbelievers, they want to extinguish the light of Allah, the truth that Allah has made evident. And how do they wish to extinguish it? With their mouths, with their words of mockery, with their words of denial, raising objections at the ayat of Allah. But Allah refuses that that light be extinguished. Allah refuses except to perfect His light, even though the disbelievers dislike it. Even if they dislike the nur of Allah, Allah will still establish it. He will still perfect it. In the next ayah, Allah says, هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْمُشْرِكُونَ It is He who has sent His messenger with guidance and the religion of truth to manifest it over all other religions, even though the mushrikeen dislike it. So when Allah has sent the truth, He will make it prevail. And whatever efforts people use against the deen of Allah, against the haqq, all these efforts are useless. And this Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows to us. Like for example, what happened when Musa alayhi salam came to Fir'aun? Fir'aun refused to accept. He was so proud and he was so persistent in his arrogance, in his denial, for many, many years. But what happened eventually? The truth prevailed. Fir'aun, him and his civilization came to an end. And Musa alayhi salam, the Bani Israel, they crossed the sea. And Musa alayhi salam, what was he given? The Kitab. And after him, who inherited the book? The Bani Israel. So, the truth will prevail. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says over here, فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ Seek refuge with Allah. Why? Because when people are arguing against the ayat of Allah, they're raising objections, then this is a satanic act. Because who wants truth to be suppressed? Shaitan. He doesn't want people to know. So this is a satanic act. And it's quite possible that if a person is witnessing some jidal concerning the ayat of Allah, his own beliefs get shaken. He may get influenced. Therefore, when people are arguing in this way, they're raising objections in this way, then immediately seek protection with Allah. That, oh Allah, You protect me. You save me. Don't let me get influenced by these people, by what they're saying. And this happens even today. People raise objections against the Quran, against the Sunnah, and what happens? We're like, yeah, that makes sense. What about this and what about that? So, فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ Every time you hear something against the deen of Allah, seek Allah's protection. Ya Allah, protect my faith. Give me courage. You protect me against these people. And we see that Musa alayhi salam, when Fir'aun threatened him, that ذَرُونِي أَقْتُلْ مُوسَى وَلْيَدْعُ رَبَّهِ What did Musa alayhi salam do? In the same surah, ayah 27, we learn, وَقَالَ مُوسَى إِنِّي عُزْتُ بِرَبِّي وَرَبِّكُمْ مِنْ كُلِّ مُتَكَبِّرٍ لَا يُؤْمِنُ بِيَوْمِ الْحِسَابِ Because who argues with the ayat of Allah? متكبر الَّذِي لَا يُؤْمِنُ بِيَوْمِ الْحِسَابِ So Musa alayhi salam, he sought refuge with Allah against who? Fir'aun and his plots. And what happened? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected him. Allah saved him. Where Fir'aun was doing jidal with the ayat of Allah, a person from his own family stood up in defense of the ayat of Allah. So, فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ Seek refuge with Allah in order to protect yourself from their plots, from their attacks, from getting influenced by them. And remember that Allah, He is Samir and He is Basir. He will protect you. لَخَلْقُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ The creation of the heavens and the earth. لَخَلْقُ Surely the creation of the heavens and the earth. It is أَكْبَرُ مِنْ خَلْقِ النَّاسِ It is greater than the creation of people. If you look at the skies above you, anywhere you look up, what do you find? The sky. It's so huge. You look to the right, you find the sky. You look to the left, you see the sky. You look right above you, sky. Before you, sky. Behind you, sky. It's huge, massive. And the earth, again, if you look around yourself, what do you see? The earth. So imagine how massive, how vast the skies and the earth are. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the creation of the skies and the earth is much greater than the creation of people. It's much easier for Allah to create people. Why? Because compare people to the skies and the earth. The skies and the earth, so huge. And people, what's their size? So tiny, so little, so insignificant. The sky and the earth with all of their systems are so intricate. And people, yes, of course, even they're very intricate, their bodies. But if you think about it, what's more complicated? The sky and the earth. So, لَخَلْقُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَكْبَرُ مِنْ خَلْقِ النَّاسِ وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. But most people, they do not know. And this is why they become arrogant. You see, if a person reflects on the creation that surrounds him, it will make him humble. And if a person thinks he's the best, then it will only make him arrogant. If you look at the sky, if you look at the earth, and you compare yourself to the sky and the earth, what are you? Nothing. Nothing at all. So pride, arrogance, it does not befit a human being. It does not befit him even a little bit. So over here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that the sky and the earth, their creation is much greater than the creation of human beings. So people have no right to be arrogant. وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. But most people, they do not know. This is why they're arrogant. وَمَا يَسْتَوِي الْأَعْمَى وَالْبَصِيرِ. And not equal are the blind and the seeing. Are they equal? A person who can see, a person who cannot see. They're not equal. Because the one who can see, his knowledge is much more broad compared to the one who cannot see. The one who can see, he knows about what different colors are. He has learned about so many things just by seeing. The one who cannot see, his knowledge is limited. His understanding is limited. And over here, al-a'ma wal-basir, this can be understood in the literal sense and also in the figurative sense. That al-a'ma, the blind one, who does it refer to? The one who is heedless. Who sees, but he doesn't understand. He sees the sky above him, the earth around him. He sees their vastness, but still he does not understand how small he is. And he doesn't recognize the might and power of Allah. So who is arma? The ghafil person, the heedless person, the one who does not ponder, the one who does not reflect on the creation of the heavens and the earth. And who is basir? Who is basir? The one who can see. The one who is alive in his heart. The one who reflects. The one who has knowledge. The one who has insight. The one who sees the signs. And he reaches a conclusion. And what is that conclusion? The greatness of the might and power of Allah. So the arma, the basir, they are not the same. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. And those who believe and do righteous deeds, وَلَا الْمُسِيءُ. And nor the one who does evil. Who is musi? Musi, the one who does su. And musi, what kind of a noun is it? Ism? Fa'il. Very good. Because it begins with meem with a dhamma on it. So muf'il. Okay? Isa'ah from bab if'al. Okay? Isa'ah is to do su. Musi is the one who does su. Okay? Isa'ah is the masdar and musi is the ism fa'il. So those who believe and do righteous deeds, they are not equal to who? The one who does evil. They are very different. That just as the blind and seeing are not the same, similarly the doer of good and the doer of evil, they are not the same. Just as the ignorant and the knowledgeable, they are not the same. The one who has iman and the one on kufr, even they are not the same. قَلِيلًا مَا تَذَكَّرُونَ. Little is that you remember. Meaning, very little is it that you understand, you remember, you take lesson. So on one side are the blind, on the other side are the seeing. On one side are the arrogant, on the other side are the humble, who recognize the truth, who accept the truth, submit to the truth. On one side is the one who does jidal with the ayat of Allah, on the other side is the one who accepts them. Wholeheartedly, with submission. On the one hand is the one who believes, he does good. On the other hand is the one who does evil, who disbelieves. Can they be the same? Not at all. In Surah Hud, ayah 24, Allah says, مَثَلُ الْفَرِيقَيْنِ كَالْأَعْمَى وَالْأَصَمِّ وَالْبَصِيرِ وَالسَّمِيعِ هَلْ يَسْتَوِيَانِ مَثَلًا أَفَلَا تَذَكَّرُونَ. In Surah Sa'd, ayah 28, Allah says, أَمْ نَجْعَلُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ كَالْمُفْسِدِينَ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَمْ نَجْعَلُ الْمُتَّقِينَ كَالْفُجَّارِ. No. Should we treat those who believe and do righteous deeds like corruptors in the land? Or should we treat those who fear Allah like the wicked ones? No. The two are completely different. And the two will meet completely different ends in the hereafter as well. And in this is a warning. That one way is of jidal with the ayat of Allah. The other way is of acceptance. And both lead to completely different ends in dunya and the hereafter. إِنَّ السَّاعَةَ لَآتِيَةٌ Indeed the hour, surely it is coming. The hereafter, the day of judgment, it is definitely coming. And over there people will meet their final end. People will get what they deserve. لَا رَيْبَ فِيهَا There is no doubt concerning it. It's inevitable. It's definitely coming. وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ But most people, they do not believe. They don't affirm it's coming. Why? Because they're lost in the dunya. Something that is so certain. Look at the emphasis over here, the tawqeed over here. إِنَّ السَّاعَةَ لَآتِيَةٌ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهَا That definitely, surely, indeed, the hour is coming and there is no doubt concerning it. It's definitely coming. But still, most people don't know. Something that is so certain, but most people don't believe in it. They doubt its existence altogether. They doubt its possibility, its coming altogether. In Surah Al-Furqan, Ayah 11, Allah says, بَلْ كَذَّبُوا بِالسَّاعَةِ Rather, they have denied the sa'ah. They don't believe in it. They reject it. Whereas it is something that is so certain, it will definitely come. And the thing is that the one who denies the hereafter, the one who denies judgment, who denies recompense, then he is the one who becomes proud. He is the one who does jidal with the ayat of Allah. Because he does not fear any consequences of his actions. And a person who is concerned about the hereafter, he believes in it, then what will happen? He will become careful. He will not say, yes, I know what Allah is saying, however, I don't accept it. I know this is in the Quran, however, it doesn't make any sense to me, therefore I'm not going to do it. No, it's not possible. Who is mutakabbir? لا يؤمن بيوم الحساب. The one who does not believe in the day of hisab, in the day of account. So this is the root of many, many problems. Many problems. So, إِنَّ السَّاعَةَ لَآتِيَةٌ لَا غَيْبَ فِيهَا وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ And this is why they do jidal in the ayat of Allah. وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ And your Lord says, أُدْعُونِي Call upon me. Make dua to me. أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ I will respond to you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, your Lord says, your Khaliq, your Malik, your Raziq, He says, أُدْعُونِي Meaning He commands you that you should call upon Him. And udu'uni dua is of different types. Dua of ibadah and dua of mas'ala, asking. So udu'uni, what does it mean? That worship me. Astajib lakum, I will respond to you, meaning I will reward you. Secondly, udu'uni, meaning saluni, ask me. Astajib lakum, meaning أعطيكم, I will give you. So, أدعوني أستجب لكم. Worship me and I will reward you. أدعوني أستجب لكم. Ask me and I will give you. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says over here, أدعوني. أدعو is what? فعل أمر. What does it show? The obligation of worshipping Allah. The obligation of making dua to Allah. It's an obligation. It's not a choice. Worshipping Allah is not a choice. Rather, it is a command that we have been given. So a person cannot say, oh, I choose not to pray. I choose not to fast. I choose not to do this. No, this is not a choice that we have been given. These are obligations. Similarly, making dua to Allah. A person cannot say, I can't be bothered to make dua to Allah. No. This is an obligation because Allah is saying, Udu'uni. And call upon me, Astajib lakum. Astajib is actually Astajibu. But this is shortened. So Astajib from Jawab, that I will respond to you. The Jawab, the response is guaranteed. How many times does it happen? that you ask someone for something, you call them, and you get a response. Not every time. But the response from Allah, that is guaranteed. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ, indeed those people who يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِي, they are arrogant from my worship. They are too proud to worship Allah. Which is why they say, I choose not to pray. I can't be bothered to pray. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِي. And over here, ibadah, what does it mean? Dua and also worship. Because dua, that is worship. We learn from hadith that inna dua huwa al-ibadah. So inna alladhina yastakbiruna an ibadati, those who are arrogant from my worship, too arrogant to pray to me, sayadukhuluna jahannama dakhirin, they will enter into hellfire as ones who are humiliated. Dakhirin, plural of dakhir. And dakhir is one who suffers from dukhur. What is dukhur? To be small, to be dishonored, to be contemptible, to be despicable, to deserve hatred. Those who are made small. So سَيَدُخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ الدَّاخِرِينَ, those who are too proud to worship Allah, they will be admitted into hellfire as ones who are humiliated. They were proud, Allah will bring them down. They were arrogant, Allah will disgrace them. What do we see in this ayah? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us to worship Him. Allah is commanding us to make dua to Him. Why? What's the reason behind that? It makes us humble. It is the purpose of our creation. So the purpose for which we have been created, we must fulfill it. Because if we don't, then we're useless. To be saved from hellfire. Because those who are too arrogant to worship Allah, سَيَدُخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ دَاخِرِينَ. Why else do we have to worship Allah? Why else do we have to make dua? It's for our own benefit. We need Allah. We need to worship Him. It's mentioned over here, Udu'uni astajib lakum. One of the meanings is, worship me and I will reward you. Are we not in need of reward? Do we not need it? Of course we do. And Udu'uni astajib lakum, call upon me, make dua to me, I will respond to you. Do we not need help? Do we not need protection? Do we not need so many things? And people, naturally, they have this desire to call upon someone for help. We see that little children even, what happens to them? They get stuck in something and they say, please help. They look at you, little children. Just the other day I was sitting in the cafeteria and little children, they were sitting and playing around and one child was being beaten by the other and the one who was being beaten is just looking at me. She never looks at me, never smiles at me, but she's just looking at me like, will you save me? So this is something natural. This is in the fitrah of people. This is why whenever we're in trouble, we look around ourselves. We depend on others. We seek help from others. So this is in the fitrah of people. This is the purpose of our lives. This is why udu'uni astajib lakum. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding us to worship Him, commanding us to make dua for Him, because it is our need. It is our purpose of life. We are His servants and He is the Master. We are dependent on Him. He is our Rabb, our Lord. And Lord is someone that the slave needs. So, udu'uni astajib lakum. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He encourages us to worship over here by telling us that the response is guaranteed. Look at the encouragement. Your worship, your dua will not go waste. Because أَسْتَجِبُ لَكُمْ, the response is guaranteed. I will definitely respond to you. And just as we have been given many other commands to pray salah, to give zakat, we have also been given the command to make dua. Because dua is of the best forms of worship. Why? How? Because dua combines many, many acts of worship. Or it combines many great virtues. It's of the greatest manifestations of ibadah. That when a person is making dua, what did you learn? Then it combines together feeling of hope, fear, love, humility. calling upon Allah. So all of these feelings are combined together in dua. This is why dua is the essence of worship. It is worship. There is humility. You have fear. You have hope. You have love. So all of these feelings are combined together. What is ibadah? If you think about it, what is worship? To show humility. Al-khudu' wa tadallul. So dua that shows khudu' and tadallul, that shows humility and submissiveness. You're calling upon Allah because you realize you need Him. You're calling upon Allah because you know He can fulfill your need. You know He can answer your prayer. It shows that you believe in His asma and sifat. It shows that you believe that He is ilah. It shows that you believe He is Rabb. So, ud'uni astajib lakum. Why make dua? Because it is of the best forms of worship. And we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves it when a person makes dua to Him. And when a person does not make dua to Him, Allah gets upset with him. From a hadith we learned that مَنْ لَمْ يَسْأَلِ اللَّهَ يَغْضَبْ عَلَيْهِ. The one who does not ask Allah, Allah becomes angry with him. Which is why it is said that إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِي سَيَدُخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ دَاخِرِينَ. That those who don't make dua, they're too arrogant to pray to Allah. They think they're fine on their own. They don't need to worship Allah. They don't need to ask Him for help. This is pride. This is arrogance. And Allah gets upset with the person who does not ask Him. In Surah Al-Baqarah, Ayah 186, we learn, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانَ. I respond to the invocation of the supplicant when he calls upon me. So whenever a person makes dua to Allah during the day, during the night, while standing, while sitting, while lying down, while he's driving, while he's sitting, while he's waiting, when he's in difficulty, when he's not in difficulty, when he's ill, when he's fine, when he's suffering from a problem, whatever situation a person may be in, if a person makes dua to Allah, what do we learn? أستجب لكم فإني قريب. Indeed, I am near. Now, from this ayah we learn a number of things. First of all, one of the most important things that we learn from this ayah is that a person must make dua to Allah. We think that we should only make dua when we need something. But the fact is that a person must turn to Allah, praying to Him for even the smallest of things. Because this shows servitude. If you look at the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, we see that he made dua when? All the time. When he woke up, when he wore new clothes, when he went to the washroom, when he came out of the washroom, when he ate something, after he ate something. This is what the sunnah teaches us. Making dua to Allah all the time. And we think we only have to make dua when something big happens. Or when we need a huge favor. But the reality is that the more humble a person is, the more he will make dua to Allah. And we see that the angels who are so close to Allah, we learned in the surah, the honorable angels who are so close to Allah, even they make dua to Allah. Isn't it? If you think about it, are they mukallaf? Will they be held accountable for their deeds? No. But still we see that they make dua to Allah. Why? Because making dua to Allah is ibadah. And that is what we have been created for. Similarly, we see that the Prophet ﷺ, the best of human beings, what was he told? وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لِذَنْبِكَ. You all to seek forgiveness, meaning make dua to Allah. So no matter who a person is, no matter what state he is in, no matter what situation he is in, no matter what level he is at, what is he required to do? Make dua to Allah. For himself and also for others. Also we learn from this ayah, that Allah, He responds to the dua of the caller. أستجب لكم. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. Now it happens, we make dua to Allah, it's responded. And sometimes we make dua to Allah, and we say that I prayed, but I never got anything. Or I worshipped, I did that act of worship, I did that ritual, I fasted, I went for umrah, I went for this, I went for that, but I don't see any positive effects of it in my life. I don't feel that my good deeds have been accepted. Because if they were accepted, then this and this would happen. But what do we learn over here? That أستجب لكم. So how do we understand this? that the fact is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds in different ways. The response is guaranteed. أَسْتَجِبُ لَكُمْ. The response is guaranteed, but it's not necessary that the response will be exactly what you want it to be. How? Like, for example, we learn from a hadith, Abu Sa'id al-Khudri reported that the Prophet ﷺ said that no Muslim makes a dua unless he is someone who has cut off his relatives, but that he is given one of three things. Either his supplication is answered quickly, meaning whatever he prayed for, he is given, or it is stored up for him in the next world, meaning he makes dua, he makes it again and again. It's an act of worship. And he will get reward for it where? In the hereafter. So a person should never stop making dua. Even if he does not see the answer, even if he does not see it getting responded to, he should continue making dua. Why? Because dua is an act of worship. And for an act of worship, Allah will reward. So the reward is preserved for the hereafter, in the next world. Or an evil equal to it is averted from him. An evil that is equal to the dua that he was making is averted from him. So it was said, then many supplications will be made. That if Allah responds in so many different ways, then, you know, we should make a lot of dua. The Prophet ﷺ replied, Allah has more still to give. أَسْتَجِبُ لَكُمْ. Even if you don't voice your dua, it's in your heart, you don't even know how to put it in words, Allah hears, He responds. Sometimes it's just a wish in the heart, and you hope that Allah will fulfill that wish, and you don't even voice it. But what happens? Because Allah is Qareeb, He is Samir, He is Mujib, He responds to the dua, and later on you realize that, oh, you know, I never even made dua actively for it, but it was just a wish in my heart, and Allah fulfilled it. So, أَسْتَجِبُ لَكُمْ, the response is guaranteed. How? In many different ways. And secondly, أَسْتَجِبُ لَكُمْ, a dua may not be answered to because of some problem, some reason that is preventing the dua from getting accepted. A person is making dua. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said dua will be responded to. Response is guaranteed. However, the dua, there's some problem with it, which is why the response is not being received by the person. Now over here, a person cannot blame dua. He should blame himself. Like for example, a knife. Does it cut things? Does it? It does. If you cut an apple with a knife, will it cut the apple? Yes. But if you take a kitchen knife and you start cutting your iron with it, will it cut the iron? No. So can you say, oh, this knife is useless? You can't say that. Because you're not using the right tool. You're not using it in the right place. There's some problem in the procedure. So you cannot blame the knife. Who do you have to blame? Yourself. So what is it that prevents the dua from getting accepted? There are many things. First of all, that a person is not fulfilling the conditions of making dua. What are the conditions of making dua? That a person should make dua with iman. We learned earlier, وَمَا دُعَاءُ الْكَافِرِينَ إِلَّا فِي ضَلَالٍ. So first of all, a person must have iman. Secondly, another condition of dua is to have yaqeen, that my dua will be accepted by Allah. We learn from a hadith, Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu reported, the Prophet ﷺ said, when one of you makes a dua, he should not say, if you wish, that, oh Allah, give this to me if you wish, forgive me if you wish. But rather, he should be firm in asking, and he should have great hope, because Allah does not think that anything that he gives is too great. Similarly, from another hadith we learn, that when one of you makes a dua, he should be firm in the supplication, and he should not say, oh Allah, if you like, give me. Because Allah cannot be forced against his will anyway. So, what do we learn? That first of all, one of the things that prevents dua from getting accepted is not fulfilling the conditions. Of the conditions is iman. Of the conditions is yaqeen. And there are other conditions as well. Another thing that could prevent duas from getting accepted is that a person is committing something wrong. he is abandoning what is mandatory, what is wajib. He is falling short in his actions overall. Like, for example, if a person has cut off relations, meaning he has cut off his relationship with his relatives. You're not my brother. I'm never going to speak to you again. It's been years and years, and a person does not speak to his mother, he doesn't speak to his sister, he doesn't speak to his niece. There's a blood relationship, but a person has cut that off. Then this prevents dua from getting accepted. Because that hadith, which tells us about the three ways in which Allah responds to the dua of the da'i, the Prophet ﷺ said that no Muslim makes supplication unless he is someone who has cut off from his relatives. So if a person has cut off from his relatives, then this will prevent his du'as from getting accepted. So we have to look at ourselves. The problem is not with the du'a, the problem is with who? Ourselves. We are falling short in doing something. We are doing something wrong because Allah has said, أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. The problem is with us then. Another wrong action that prevents du'a from getting accepted is haram income. أَكْلُ الْحَرَامِ. If a person consumes that which is haram, we learn from a hadith that a person who is traveling, he's all disheveled and he calls upon Allah, but how can his dua be accepted when his clothing is haram, when his body is haram, when his nourishment is haram? It will not be accepted. So a person should also make dua to Allah that if there are any sins that are preventing my dua from getting accepted, forgive those sins. Right? And similarly, the little sins that we commit, the small sins that we commit, they also are enough to prevent our dua from getting accepted. Remember that hadith that a people, they're traveling, they camp somewhere, and all of them go in order to collect firewood. Each person brings small pieces of firewood, and what happens? When they light that fire, it's enough to burn. So similarly, when a person has committed many, many sins, even if they're small, then what happens? They are enough to destroy him. They are enough to prevent his dua from getting accepted. So firstly, what is it that prevents dua from getting accepted? Not fulfilling the conditions. Secondly, committing that which is wrong. And thirdly, the dua itself is incorrect. The dua is not correct. Like for example, a person is praying against someone when they don't deserve that. A person is praying against someone when they don't deserve that. For example, a person says, "Oh Allah, don't give such and such person tawfiq to do good." Or for example, a person makes dua, "Oh Allah, this person who's so good in my class, don't let them do well in their test." Is this right? This is zulm. This is incorrect. Allah does not respond to such prayers. When the dua itself is wrong, then Allah will not hear it. Allah will not accept it. Similarly, if a person makes dua, "Oh Allah, you know, make this building of gold." Okay, inna Allah ala kulli shayin qadir. It's not difficult for Allah. However, it is khilaful adah. It is against the norm. This is something that doesn't generally happen. Now over here, you don't start doubting the power of Allah, but you're asking for something that's unreasonable. So sometimes the dua itself is incorrect. We have to put in our share, we have to do our part in order for duas to be accepted. That what do we learn from that ayah? That فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي. That they should respond to me and they should believe in me as well. So what does it mean by responding to Allah? That a person obeys Allah. A person is hopeful in Allah. And وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي, that they should believe in me. They should prove their iman in me. Of the conditions of dua is also that a person should not be hasty. So if a person is being hasty, that, "Oh, I made dua yesterday, it should be accepted today." This is incorrect. Because if you look at Ibrahim alayhi salam, he made dua when he built the Kaaba. And when was it fulfilled? After so long, thousands of years. That's when the Prophet ﷺ came. Similarly, we see Ayyub alayhi salam. He was in so much difficulty. He suffered for so long, for years and years. But his difficulty was removed from him after a long period of time. Yaqub alayhi salam, he lost his son, Yusuf. But what happened? He got him, he found him after many, many years. So we have to learn to be patient as well. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says over here, "Udu'uni astajib lakum." The response is guaranteed, but remember that the response, first of all, is in different ways. Secondly, there is something that is preventing the dua from getting accepted. So we have to fix ourselves. We have to fix our dua. We have to fix the way that we make dua. And thirdly, if there is a dua that you're making and you're consciously making, fulfilling all of the conditions, and you can't figure out why the dua is not being accepted, then just accept that this is the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If a person says the durood, he sends the peace and blessings upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam while making dua before and after, that is a means of dua getting accepted. So if a person does not do that, he does not avail the right moments, like for example after adhan, before iqama, then it's not that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not respond, but rather there's something wrong with the dua that we're making. It's naqis, it's incomplete, it's not fulfilling the conditions. So وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ اُدْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبُ لَكُمْ. And there's a warning that إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِي سَيَدُخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ دَاخِرِينَ. There's a severe warning in this. Now sometimes you might be in a particular problem and you wonder, what do I ask Allah for? What if this problem is good for me? Like you begin to wonder that, you know, عَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. So maybe I should not make dua to Allah for this problem to be removed, because Allah knows best. Should you make dua? Of course you should. Because whatever Allah decides will ultimately happen. But if you make dua, then this will bring you closer to Allah. This will help you accept the situation that you're in. And this will also bring you reward. So never stay away from making dua. Never. And when a person is making dua for other believers, then the angels also say ameen. So be careful about the dua that you make for other believers. Like for example, sometimes people say, just to tease the other person, may Allah give you a lot of children, and may Allah, you know, do this for you and that for you. So, I mean, definitely, it's very good. But I'm just saying that sometimes we make dua just to tease the other person. But remember, when you're making dua for other believer, the angel says, ameen for you as well.